Hello, and thank you for watching my videos. My name is Jason Johnson, and this is going to be Chapter 4 Challenges, Part 1 for the Prelude to Programming textbook. We are going to do the first four. This is Part 1. Part 2 will have a link in the comments below. The four challenges that we're going to do are on the screen here. The first one is we need to input a number entered by the user and display positive if it's greater than 0, and negative if it is less than 0, and 0 if it's equal to 0. So we're going to have a series of choices here when we put the information in. So what we're going to do is we're going to build this in Raptor here. And I've already got it pre-built, but I'm going to walk through the different steps. So we're going to output to the user, and let's put a comment here. I'm just going to right mouse click and show you how to do a comment. So we're just going to say this, and we're going to say output to user, saying what the program does. Now, it's important when you do comments in any type of programming where there may be a reason down the road for you to not remember what happened, or for someone else that picks up the program. So always leave comments. Comment in your work, whether you're writing HTML code, whether you're writing Python, any other type of programming. You want to always leave, Java, whatever. You want to leave comments so that one, a couple of weeks down the road, you remember what you were doing, or that someone else that picks up the program, they'll know what's doing, what is going on. So if you remember back, it said that we need to select a series of choices here, and we need to select to see if the number is either positive or negative. So we're going to output to the user and tell them that that's what we're doing. Then we're going to ask, or we're going to set number 1 to 0. So we're going to do an assignment here, and we're just going to set that to 0, set number 1 to 0. And then we're going to ask the user to enter a number, and then whatever number they enter is going to be the number 1. And so it can be either a negative number, it can be 0, or it can be a positive number. But we might even say something here and say enter a whole number. We might even tell the user, say enter a whole number, either positive or negative, or a 0. So we could do that so that we get a little bit more clear explanation. And then we're going to go into a decision tree here, or we're going to do a selection. And we're going to compare our variable of number 1, whatever that user put in, we're going to compare it and we're going to say, is it greater than 0? If it's greater than 0, that means it's a positive number. And the choice is going to go to the yes side, and we're going to output to the user, your number is positive. If it's not greater than 0, that means it's either 0 or a negative number. So we're going to go to our next spot here and we're going to say, is it less than 0? If it's less than 0, that means it's negative. So our output's going to go to the yes side of the tree, and it's going to say your number's negative. If it's not greater than 0 and it's not less than 0, the logic dictates that it's 0. So if it's no at that point, it's going to say your number is 0, and it will end the program. So let's just run through. I'm not going to do a step-by-step. It's just going to do each one here. It's going to set number 1 to 0, and it's going to ask us to put a number in, and let's just put in 456. We're going to click OK. In this case, it was greater than 0, so it gave us a value of number is positive. Let's run it again and put in a negative number. We'll put in negative 456, and this time it goes and it says that's a negative number. And if we ran it one more time and we put a 0 in, we know now that our program is going to work because it's going to go to the 0 side and it's going to say your number is 0. And there we go. That's the first challenge. The second challenge we have is to develop a menu-driven program that inputs two numbers and at the user's option finds whether it's a sum, are we adding it, a difference, are we subtracting it, is it a product, are we multiplying it, or is it a quotient, are we dividing it. So we're going to start on our program here and we're going to output to the user. I'm not going to put comments on this one, but I encourage you to do commenting on your programs. So you're going to put your output here. We're going to set our variables and we're going to set number 1 and number 2 because remember our program said two numbers. So we need to set our number 1 and our number 2 and we're going to set those variables to 0. Then we're going to set a variable of answer to 0 and then we're going to set a choice to 0. So that's four of our assignments that we're going to set. And then we're going to come on down here and we're going to ask the user to put in number 1, number 2, and here is we're going to say enter 1 to add the numbers because here's where we're going to set our choices. We're going to say if it's a 1, it's going to equal 1. It's going to do our choice here. If it's a 2, it's going to do this choice tree. If it's a 3, we'll have that. And I'm going to scroll all the way over here to 4 and it will say that. So this looks big and scary, but it's really not. It's just spread out because we're doing a lot of choices here. So the user is going to put in 1, 2, 3, or 4. If it's not equal to 1, if they put in something different than that, it's going to come all the way over here to the end, and it's going to say, not sure what you meant. Your response does not match any of the options. So if their number does not equal 1, 2, 3, or 4, it's going to come all the way over here and end the program and say, we don't know what you're talking about, or we don't know what you were asking. But each one of these is just going to be a simple choice. We're going to say, is the choice equal to 1? Equal, equal. So it'll look just like that. Is the choice, is the variable choice equal to 1? If it is, it comes over here and it says, oh, then you want to add. So we're going to add whatever is in number 1 and number 2 together, and that's our new answer. And then we're going to output the user. The sum is, and we're saying sum because we added, and whatever was in the variable of answer. And the same way here for choice number 2, except this time we're going to say, we're going to subtract those numbers. And then we're going to say the difference is whatever the difference was between those two numbers. And then here for choice 3, if we are multiplying, we're just going to say take whatever is number 1, multiply by number 2, and that's the product. See, number 1 divided by number, or number 1 multiplied by number 2. I almost said that wrong. And then we're going to come down here for choice number 4. And as I showed you just previously, if it's not 1, 2, 3, or 4, it's just going to output and say, we don't know what you meant. If it is number 4, now we need to do a couple of things here. First of all, we are dividing at this point. So we are doing a divisor, and we need to make sure that we're not dividing by 0. So our second choice here, if it is dividing, if we are saying, we come back up here and we made the choice that we want to divide. So if we make choice number 4 here, and we say we're going to divide, and it is equal to 4, we're going to come in here and we're going to check the number 2 first to see if it's equal to 0. If it's not equal to 0, if number 2 is not equal to 0, if it's 1 or greater, then we're going to say no, it's not. If it's not equal to 0, it's going to say no, it's not equal to 0. And then we can go ahead and divide number 1 by number 2 and give it the quotient answer. However, if number 2 is equal to 0, we need to check and make sure that we flip those around. So instead of dividing number 1 by number 2, we have to come down here and divide number 2 by number 1. We have to put our divisor backwards. Or so we can multiply. We don't want to multiply by, or we don't want to divide by 0. So we're going to say, is our number 1 equal to 0? If it's is yes, then that means both numbers are 0, and we can't say the division by 0 is not valid, because we can't divide 0 by 0. Mathematically. So it just kicks out the program and finishes the program. If number 1 is equal or is not equal to 0, so number 2 is equal to 0, we're going to check number 1 and it's not, it's another number, then we can come down and we're going to flip number 2 to this side, and then we're going to say the quotient is whatever that answer is. So let's run through this real quick, and I'm not going to do a step by step. So we're going to set our number 1, our number 2, our answer. And we're going to say, what is our first number? And let's just say that we're going to do 50. And we're going to say, what is our second number? And we're going to say 25. Make it easy. And it's going to come down here. And now we're going to do a choice. And I'm going to go ahead and do divide here, because we know our program. Well, I know my program is going to work on add, subtract, or multiply. And I'm going to go ahead and show the division. So it's going to say 4 here. And it's going to come down here. And it's going to go all the way to 4. And it said, well, I didn't do a step-by-step. It said number 2 was not equal to 0, so it just went ahead and did the division. But if I made number 2 0, it would have flipped the two numbers around. So if it would have been like 100 and 0, it would have flipped those around and it put 0 and then divided by 100 and done that. Okay, so that was number 2. The number 3 challenge is to input a number, whatever number it is, and create a program that allows the user to select finding the area of one of the following. Okay, so we're going to do our area of the square with side x. It gives us our formulas here. Area equals x times x. The area of a circle with a radius, and our formula here is area equals pi times x to the second power. And the area of equilateral triangle with side x, and our formula here is area equals square 3 divided by 4 times x to the power of 2. And now, because x represents a dimension, we require that x be greater than 0. So we want to make sure that we include that requirement in the program. So we're going to check to make sure that the number is greater than 0. Okay, so on our program here, I've got a few comments. Let me make this just a little bit larger here. So we're going to output to the user what this program is doing. The program will accept a number. The user can then choose whether to compute the area of the square, area of a circle, or radius of x, or the area of an equilateral triangle, which means all three sides are equal. And we're going to set our variable to x0. You can do these other comments here. Like this one is really not necessary because we know what it's doing, but it's just showing you that you can set a comment on there. We're going to set our answer x to 0, our answer to 0, and then our choice to 0. So we need these three variables. And we're going to ask the user to enter a whole number greater than 0. So we are telling the user we need a whole number greater than 0. And now we're checking to for x to be greater than 0. So we're going to say, is x less than 0? If x is less than 0, then we're going to say this calculation represents a dimension. Your number must be greater than 0. It kicks out, and then I'll have to start the program over again. We could make another choice here and have it loop back up again and say enter another choice, but we're keeping it simple on this program. If the number is a valid number within our parameters, we're going to come down and we're going to ask the user to do an input. Do you want to compute the area of the circle or triangle or a square, circle, or triangle? And we're going to base that on S for square, C for circle, or T for triangle. So if it's an S, we're just going to come down here and we're going to do our choice. Is the choice equal to S? Yes. Then we're going to do our calculation of X times X gives us our formula for the area of a square. Choice C is just like I showed you on the other formula. It's pi times X to the power of 2. And that gives us our radius. Or if it's choice T for an equilateral triangle, if it's not one of those, if it's not an S, a C, or a T, it will kick out and say, not sure what you meant by your response. We could put a loop back here and loop it back up to the choice and say, let's start, you know, start over. But in this case, we're not going to. We're going to keep it simple. And if it is a equilateral triangle, it's just going to do our formula in here. You can see that. And then it's going to give the answer. So let's do this one real quick. Let's do a circle first, or let's do the square first. So enter a whole number. So let's just say we're going to enter 50. So the area of the square, and we want square, so we're going to enter S. And I'm going to do a lowercase s. It should work, maybe. No, it didn't. It had to match exactly. So I put a lowercase s, and it said, not sure what you want to do. So let's run that again. It's got to be exactly like it said. We would have to actually have two choices in there, but we're not. So we're going to enter a 50. We're going to add a capital S now, and it's going to come down here, and it's going to give us our value. The area of the square is 50. Let's run it one more time and do a circle. Let's do the 50 again. This time we're going to do a capital C for circle. It's going to come down here. It's going to do our pi times that, and we're going to get 75,083. And we're going to run it one more time and do the equilateral triangle. We're going to do 50 again. And we're going to do capital T for equilateral triangle. And it's going to give us our answer and output it, which is 1,082. Okay, so that was challenge number 3. Challenge number 4, we're going to consider the equation of A times our AX2 plus B equals 0. So we're going to use that equation there. And we're going to say if B divided by A is less than 0, this equation has two solutions. The solutions are x1 equals square minus b divided by a, or x2 equals negative square negative b divided by a. So if b is divided by a equals 0, this equation has one solution, which is x equals 0. And if b divided by a is greater than 0, the equation has no real number solutions. So we want to write a program to have the user input any numbers for the coefficients a and b. For this equation, if a is equal to 0, terminate the program. Otherwise, we want to solve the equation. So let's take a look at this. We're going to output, we're going to set our variables here. So we're going to call a subchart to our variables, and we need to have a and b set. Then we need to have x1 and x2 set and x set based on our formulas. And we're going to set all those variables. It's going to end this part of the program and go back to our main subchart. You can add a subchart and rename it if we want to, but we can't rename this variables because we have that calling variables. Then we're going to output to the user what we're doing here. In an equation of the form, so you consider this formula, there are two one or no real solutions. This program will accept the values for the coefficients a and b, and we'll solve the equation. So we want to enter the value for the coefficient a first, and we're going to set the variable of a, whatever that is from the user. Then we're going to set b and do the exact same thing. And then we're going to come down here and we're going to do a choice. B divided by A, is it less than zero? So if our two values in is less than zero, it's going to come over here and it's going to say yes. And it's going to do the calculate the formulas that we gave over here in the textbook. One and then two. Negative B divided by A, or negative B divided by A. So this was positive, this was negative. And then put, there are two solutions, and it will give the two solutions based on those variables that have been set. If it is not less than zero, then it needs to come over here and we need to say, is B divided by A equal to zero? If it is, it needs to kick out and say there's one solution, which is X equals whatever plus X is. It will output, see, it will say X1 and X2, whatever the values are. If it's not equal to zero, the equation has no real number solutions and it will kick out. So let's do this first and say, let's run it. And if B is divided by A less than zero, so we're going to say, 25, and we'll say negative 25. And then it will come down here and it will say, give us our two coefficients and it'll do the calculation. It'll give us our two solutions, X1 equals 1 and X2 equals negative 1. And if not, it will come over here and say there's one solution, which is X equals. So if B is divided by A is equal to zero. So if we have those numbers do equal to zero, it will come and do that solution there. Okay, so this has been the Raptor challenges for chapter 4 for the Prelude to Programming textbook. My name is Jason Johnson. If you have any questions, make sure you leave a comment below. If you're one of my students, make sure you email me. Hope you have a great day. Stay safe and be excellent to each other.